over there, over there. Send the word over there. There's the anchor coming, the anchor coming. The drum, drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer. Send the word to beware. We'll be over, we're coming over. And we won't come back till it's over, over there.
Thank you. All right, so for those of you watching at home, remember to click below to like, subscribe, and favorite the when you see this on YouTube. For the rest of you, I'm Ryan Szimanski, and we'll be talking about naval arms race during World War I. All right, so in the late 19th century, new colonial powers were emerging that threatened the existing balance of power in Europe. In order to protect colonial empires and showcase their power, countries built large fleets of warships, and these fleets kept getting bigger and bigger, and the ships themselves kept getting bigger and bigger. In 1906, the British launched HMS Dreadnought, which made all previous capital ships obsolete, and that resulted in a carte blanche. And a naval arms race ensued. The military buildup is one of the main contributing factors to World War I. The delay in the peace treaty, where it took a year before the peace treaty actually went into effect after World War I, and the uneasy peace that followed. So, I like to think of myself as a naval historian, so I'm always thinking about how warships influence history. And I understand that may not be the case for everybody here. So we're going to start off by talking about some of the different types of warships that participated in the war. We'll get into some of the fleet compositions, what different countries were building, what suited their particular needs. And then, of course, we'll get into the effect that capital ships had. All right, so why exactly are capital ships important? There's a number of reasons. They're very powerful. They can control the sea. They can sail all over the world and protect the far-flung colonies. They're difficult to sink, and that's all great. Next slide. But they're very potent symbols of national pride and prestige. Why did the Ottoman Empire, the sick old man of Europe, want to build that ship up there with seven twin gun turrets? Well, because everybody else was only building ships with five or six gun turrets, and they wanted to have the biggest one for a year in there. They're visible, mobile symbols of national prestige. So, what are some of the different types of ships we're going to be talking about next? Submarines. This is the one that pretty much everyone thinks of when they think of World War I, because, submarines actually left port on a regular basis, unlike a lot of the capital ships. They're brand new, and for a while, they are pretty effective because there's no way to counter them. Sonar is in its infancy. Depth charges and other underwater weapons are in their infancy. And there's a big reluctance to use the convoy system. So submarines are able to be fairly successful. They couldn't win the war by themselves, though. They just aren't that advanced yet. So while they're important and they do get their due credit, I'm not going to be focusing on them today. Next slide. So let's start with the development of some smaller warships. You've got the torpedo boat, which comes out after the invention of the Whitehead torpedo in 1868, designed by this guy down here. That's Robert Whitehead, and that's one of his torpedoes. And it is a great, cheap alternative to building large battleships, because you can now put that torpedo on a submarine or on a torpedo boat like this. And in the case of a submarine, you can sneak it past the enemy fleet and attack a battleship, which at this point has no underwater protection. Or with torpedo boats, they're a little bit bigger and a little bit faster than your average picket boats in port. So you can run these through These torpedo boats up here are some of the ones from the Japanese squadron that attacked Port Arthur during the Russo-Japanese War. You just run it straight through the picket boats and are able to attack a fleet in port. Next slide, please. Parallel to the development of the torpedo boat is the torpedo boat destroyer. The name says it all here. They're designed to replace the existing picket boats. They're supposed to be as big as torpedo boats, and they carry guns so they can defend the fleet from torpedo boats. Next slide. The obvious evolution here is that those two classes of ships merge into one, simply called the destroyer. And it becomes a good general purpose escort. It has guns for dealing with other destroyers. It has torpedoes for if it runs into bigger ships. And eventually it gets the weapons to protect the fleet against underwater threats, submarines. Yes, yeah, this is, I think it's one of the Clemson-class destroyers, or maybe one of the earlier ones. I have no idea what's going on in the picture. I think it's Billy Mitchell's wet dream. But a nice, cool picture of an iconic destroyer, one of the American Four Pipers. Next slide, please. So, destroyers are still around today. In fact, they're one of the few types of ships I'm going to talk about that are still around today. Because these ships have a tendency to grow over the years, particularly during the first couple years of the 20th century. The larger ships, as they grow, they become too expensive. So destroyers here have started to grow into capital ships in their own right. So you have them developed to protect other ships in port and at sea, and now they've become so large and sophisticated that they're worth being targets for other ships to attack. And this is the USS Cole after the attack in Yemen. All right, so let's move on to cruisers. The next step up from destroyers is cruisers. They're the medium-sized warship. They're faster than battleships, about as fast as destroyers. They're a little bit larger. They carry more guns, usually not the same torpedo armament. And they are another good general-purpose ship. You can use them as scouts. You can use them as flagships for destroyer squadrons or for colonial stations. They're good as commerce raiders. This is the German cruiser Emden, which sailed around the Pacific and Indian Ocean early in the war and did a good job at commerce raiding. And they're also used as commerce protection. The British love their cruisers being able to patrol the empire. All right, next slide, please. So the idea of the cruiser dates back a couple hundred years. It's not so much a type of ship during the 16, 17, 1800s, rather a job description, but these ships, frigates and sloops of war, do the same job. They're the mid-sized sailing ships that grow into the mid-sized steam-powered warships. Now, cruisers have grown so large that there are only three countries that still use them. The United States, Russia, and Peru has one. And as far as I know, there are no plans to replace those with new classes of cruisers. So cruisers are going the way of the dinosaur and the battleship, it seems. But it's kind of difficult to trace the evolution of cruisers. You know where they begin and you know where they end. But in the middle, they branch off in so many different directions that if you start from what we have now and look backwards, you have a tendency to say, all right, during World War II, there's two types of cruisers, heavy and light. And during World War I, there's two types of cruisers, armored cruisers and protected cruisers. So the tendency is, all right, armored cruisers coincide directly with heavy cruisers, and protected cruisers evolve directly into light cruisers. And that's not exactly the case. So the earliest form of cruiser is the protected cruiser. Here are pictured two examples that are still around. We've got the Olympia, which is in Philadelphia for the time being, and the Averov, which is over in Greece, I believe. No, That's the one in Russia. That's the Aurora right there. So if you ever find yourself in Russia, there's a World War I cruiser to visit. Now, protected cruisers are only armored in certain areas. They are armored against the type of guns that they carry, which means if a cruiser has 4-inch guns, it has armor to protect itself against 4-inch guns. If it has 8-inch guns like the Olympia, it's got armor to protect itself against 8-inch guns. But the way these are able to, the way they keep these light enough to be able to stay faster than the battleships is by only armoring certain areas. And for protected cruisers, that means they've got a decent amount of deck armor over the magazines and the engine rooms, but not much else in the way of armor. So let's move on to the light armored cruisers. These have more spaces that are covered by armor, but it's a little bit thinner. And they are the ones that are used as scouts for the fleet and destroyer group flagships a lot, because they're light and they're fast. They don't have the greatest armor, but they've got enough speed to stay out of harm's way, hopefully. So this is HMS Coraline, which is still over in Great Britain as a museum. So we've talked about light armored cruisers, which are essentially the smaller version of these armored cruisers. Armored cruisers start out as capital ships. They're the equivalent, the fast equivalent of the pre-dreadnought battleship that I'll be talking about eventually. They carry guns one size smaller than battleships. They are armored to protect themselves against those guns, and they tend to have a decent area of protection. They're fast, and they're designed to operate with the battle line, and they're going to evolve into battle cruisers. Battle cruisers are a little bit of a departure from armored cruisers. The idea with the battle cruiser is it's still operating with the battle line, just like the armored cruiser used to, except it doesn't have the same level of armored protection. Whereas an armored cruiser might have 8 or 10-inch guns, and it's going to have armor to protect it against 8 or 10-inch guns, battle cruisers tend to have 12-inch guns or larger, and they don't have armor that protects them from that size of projectile. They only have armor protection against smaller weapons. So the theory that Sir Jackie Fisher, the guy who comes up with this idea, has is that speed will equal armor. These ships will use their high speed to stay far away from any enemy ships, namely armored cruisers, and be able to shoot at enemy ships while they can't be shot at in return. So armor would be useless anyway, because they're not going to be taking any hits. Now, at the bottom here, that is the German armored cruiser Blücher. And interesting story there. The Germans know that the British are making HMS Dreadnought, which is going to make all previous battleships obsolete. And they know that they're making an armored cruiser variant that's going to make all previous armored cruisers obsolete. So with Dreadnought, it has the same size guns as preceding battleships. It just has more of them. So the German thought is this new type of ship is going to have the same size guns as preceding armored cruisers, just more of them. So whereas a normal armored cruiser will have maybe 4 8-inch guns, the Germans build one that has 12 8-inch guns. So they're thinking that ought to get them by pretty well. Like I was saying earlier, the British don't build, they build their battle cruisers with battleship-sized guns to completely render armored cruisers obsolete. So the Germans are left saying, Gross Gott in Himmel, what are we supposed to do with this ship? And they have to scramble to build battle cruisers that are comparable in size to the British ones. Now, interestingly, whenever battle cruisers face armored cruisers, like the Battle of the Falklands or Dogger Banks, the battle cruisers win easily. They're able to do what they're designed to do. They're able to stay at range and fire big shots with impunity and sink armored cruisers. when battle cruisers start fighting other battle cruisers and take hits, they don't do quite so well. So let's move on and see what battle cruisers evolve into. Battle cruisers become aircraft carriers. They have the exact same reason for being. They're scouting for the line of battle. Speed equals armor. They have that heavy firepower. They can make hits over the horizon while staying out of range of enemy ships. And all the ships up here are designed as battle cruisers, but completed as aircraft carriers, with the exception of the Pennsylvania down here, which is an armored cruiser, and that's the ship that was used to test taking off and landing aircraft from ships. So armored cruisers become battle cruisers, become aircraft carriers, not armored cruisers become World War II heavy cruisers. Protected cruisers become light armored cruisers, which become the treaty cruisers of the 1920s and 30s, which then become the World War II heavy and light cruisers. All right, let's finally get to battleships. So the concept of the battleship is as old as naval artillery. You put as many guns and as much protection on a slow-moving ship as you possibly can, and you line them up in a line of battle, and you put those parallel to an enemy line of battle, and you just slug it out. And whoever has better training or more ships or heavier guns can win. So these ships start out with quite literal names. Ships of the line become line of battle ships, and then once they start getting armor protection, they start getting called battleships. It's just shortened straight down to battleships. So all of the ships I'm going to talk about here were called battleships at the time they were built, but in order to distinguish the various ships that came before Dreadnought to the ships that were equal to Dreadnought to the later ships that were better than Dreadnought, historians have given them some names. So each one of these will have a different classification, but at the time when they were built, they were all just called battleships. All right, next slide, please. Thank you. So this is the USS Oregon. It is a fairly typical early pre-Dreadnought battleship. It has two main turrets. In Oregon's case, each main turret has two 13-inch guns, although most battleships are going to have an average of an 11-inch or a 12 or 11-inch gun, depending on whose country. It has a secondary armament of 8-inch guns. If you notice on each corner of the superstructure, it's got turrets for those. And then it's got just a hodgepodge of smaller guns. Pick a number between 1 and 13, and they've probably got something in that caliber sticking out of the superstructure. Those are the kinds of ships that fight during the Spanish-American War, early American pre-dreadnoughts. And they come up with some ideas. They run into some problems, and they come up with some ideas to fix them. First of all, aiming the guns is done by a junior officer who's standing up in the mast with a pair of binoculars, and he sees a splash that's in front of the enemy ship, and he calls down to the gunners down below, hey, aim more to the right, or elevate, or something like that. So aiming is not very technical, and with only a handful of large guns, it's kind of difficult to score hits, especially since that guy up there can't tell the difference between a shell splash from a 12 or 13-inch gun and a shell splash from the intermediate 8-inch guns, which are then difficult to tell the shell splashes from the 5 and 6-inch guns, and it just becomes really difficult to aim. So they don't get quite as many hits with their big guns as they do with the smaller broadside guns in the superstructure. Next slide, please. So the obvious next step is to get rid of those intermediate guns, the 8-inch guns in turrets. So you keep the two twin big guns, one at the front and one at the back, and you put a lot of broadside guns in the superstructure. And this is the Japanese battleship Mikasa, which is still over in Japan. And she's pretty typical of this generation of pre-dreadnoughts. Now, when these ships get used, they run into some issues too. Next slide, please. During the Russo-Japanese War, the Japanese had a smaller fleet, but it was really well trained. So what they did was keep their ships at longer range to disable the Russian ships before the Russians were able to score any good hits on them. So they're using those two twin turrets a lot, but they're not getting into range to use all those broadside guns that have been built into modern ships. So they come up with a quick solution. Next slide, please. They return to having a mixed battery of the two twin primary guns. In this case, with the Japanese battleship Satsuma, it's 12-inch guns, four of them. And then they have a bunch of secondary guns. In this case, she has 12 10-inch guns. And these are called semi-dreadnoughts because they haven't quite gotten there yet. It's not quite the dreadnought idea where you've got a full battery of the same size guns. They're almost there. So there's one short generation, about every country gets to build about one class of these. And then in 1906, next slide, dreadnought comes around. And that revolutionizes everything. Whereas previous ships have two main turrets, dreadnought has five. So it's now equal in fighting power to any two or sometimes three older pre-dreadnought battleships. Not only is its gunnery much better, it has new engines. So it's several knots faster than preceding pre-dreadnoughts. It's faster than some armored cruisers, so it's making them obsolete too. It has the same level of armored protection, and it's not all that larger than the preceding class of battleships. It's only 10 or 15% larger than the Lord Nelson class pre-dreadnoughts that preceded it. So it's not a massive step forward in size, but it's a huge step forward in fighting power by getting rid of the intermediate battery and replacing it with an all big gun battery. So this is what sparks the arms race during that leads directly to World War I. Great Britain has the biggest navy in the world. A couple other countries are starting to catch up, so Great Britain has to release the next biggest thing. But then everybody realizes it's a blank slate. We can just start from scratch. All right, next slide, please. Eventually, the dreadnoughts evolve into super dreadnoughts, and this is during the war years. They start getting newer, faster engines, they have new armor schemes, and they have more and heavier guns. So whereas Dreadnought has 12-inch guns, eventually the British come out with a 13.5-inch gun. The Americans and Japanese respond with a 14-inch gun, and then the British have to come back with a 15-inch gun, and it just keeps escalating and escalating in very rapid succession within a few generations of ships. Now, the leap to the super dreadnought is not really represented by a single ship. There's nothing like dreadnought where it comes through and just revolutionizes everything. It's someone releases a ship with new and better armor, and someone else releases a ship with new and better armor and some better guns, and then someone else comes along and does something a little bit bigger. Pictured in the foreground here is the USS Nevada, which is the ship that came up with the new and better armor and new and better engines. She is the first capital ship to be oil-powered. She runs off of oil instead of coal. And she has a new armor scheme called All or Nothing. Dreadnoughts and pre-dreadnoughts and armored cruisers and older types of ships, they have an armored belt that's really thick over the magazines and the engines. And they have a thinner armored belt above that that protects the crew spaces. And they have an even thinner armored belt forward and aft of that to protect some other spaces. And then the turrets have one level of armor, and the conning tower has a different level of armor. So depending on what you're shooting at them, you might be able to punch through, you might not. Nevada introduces the idea of you just have armor over the belt to protect the vital parts of the ship, and everything else is left unarmored. And by leaving the non-essential stuff unarmored, it saves a lot more weight for armoring. After the super dreadnoughts, immediately after World War I, the arms race hasn't ended. People are still building bigger and more powerful warships. During the early 1920s, there are plans in the works for large fleets of even more powerful battleships armed with 16-inch guns, and even some that are starting to be armed with 18-inch guns. And this is where people finally step in and decide to make treaties, and we'll talk about those in a second. But after the super dreadnoughts and then the battleships, you finally start to see the pre-dreadnoughts and even the first generation dreadnoughts being retired. So they are finally able to revert to the actual name of the ships, dreadnoughts instead of battleships, instead of having to distinguish between dreadnoughts and pre-dreadnoughts and everything else, because all anybody has left at this point are the battleships, because everything else is so many generations obsolete after a decade or so. All right, next slide. Huh. When are we actually going to start talking about the arms race? We've talked a lot about different types of ships. I rather think I've been clever and have been talking about it all along. We've been talking about how these ships keep progressing in size, and that's one facet of the arms race, that everybody has to build one bigger. Mine's bigger than yours. Mine's more powerful. It's got bigger guns. So let's move forward. In Europe, the naval arms race starts in the 1890s or so, largely because of the German Admiral von Tirpitz. He has this strategy that Germany can become a world power with world-class colonial possessions without fear of anybody else stepping in and interdicting with them if they can build a fleet two-thirds the size of the Royal Navy, which is the biggest fleet in the world. So if the German Navy can be that large, it means that that even if it goes into battle with the Royal Navy and loses, it destroys enough of the Royal Navy that the Royal Navy is no longer an effective fighting force. The Germans are essentially starting from scratch, so they don't have a bunch of old obsolete ships. They immediately start with the good stuff. They build a nice, well-balanced fleet, and they don't have global commitments, so their ships are only operating in the North Sea. They're not building ships like the British, which have to sail all the way around the world to protect their colonies. They don't need to worry about the crew living on board for months. They don't need to worry about a lot of fuel, because they're only worried about operating in the North Sea. So that means they're able to put a lot more armored protection into their ships than British ships. And during World War I, German ships prove to be much more survivable. They take a lot more hits than comparable British ships. Also, Germany tends to build their guns one size smaller. If the English are using 12-inch guns, the Germans are using 11-inch guns. If the English are using 13.5-inch guns, then the Germans finally upped it to 12. When the English go to 15, the Germans finally start to look at 15-inch guns themselves. But the idea there was, what's the point of having a big gun if you can only fire one shot every minute or minute and a half? You're not able to hit your target. You'd much rather smother a target in lighter shells that you can fire really fast. Great Britain has this thing called the two-power standard, which is an ancient, it dates back a long time, and it says that the Royal Navy has to be larger than the next two largest navies in the world. So as you have new powers like Germany and America beginning to take over colonial possessions and build large fleets, Great Britain is upping the production of ships that they're making. They're making more and more ships because they've got this established tradition of having enough warships that even if the next two biggest kids on the block try to pick a fight with them, they can still win. And really, it starts to end the Pax Britannia, where the British aren't really so concerned in world affairs. They're managing their colonies, but not too worried about everything else. But then when everybody else starts trying to edge in on their territory, so to speak, they really start to come out of it. They make treaties with France and Russia. They start to build more ships. That's one of the things that leads to World War I. So next slide, please. In the Pacific, you have a similar arms race going on. Japan wants to be the England of the East. They want to start an island empire with colonies in the Pacific. So they want to be able to dominate that sphere of influence. The United States is looking to build a fleet second to none. That's where that term comes from. The Americans want the largest fleet in the world. They want to beat the British. And the reason they want that is because they're operating in two different oceans. They've got to have a fleet in the Atlantic that can beat any potential aggressors there. And they need a fleet in the Pacific specifically to counter the Japanese. Next slide, please. And these aren't the only guys that are building battleships. France, Italy, Austria, Hungary, Greece, and Turkey, and Spain are all trying to get battleships. Argentina, Brazil, and Chile have a South American building race going on, where each one orders two or three battleships. Russia and even the Netherlands look to get modern battleships. So this is a worldwide phenomenon. Everybody wants the biggest ship. So the arms race can really be broken up into a couple different years. You've got the 1880s to 1906, where it's not really so much of an arms race. You've got some second-rate navies like Germany and America are trying to become first-rate navies, but they aren't really threatening anyone at this point with their pre-dreadnoughts. There is an increase in the number of ships being built, and all of this is caused by Alfred Thayer Mahan's book, The Influence of Sea Power Upon Modern History, which essentially says the country with the biggest navy can do whatever they want. So everybody likes that book, everybody cites that book and says this is why we need a bigger navy. And that's really where this arms race starts. Next slide, please. Then, of course, you have the dreadnought built, and when everybody has a blank slate, they just start it over from scratch. And so now Britain has one dreadnought. They can no longer keep the two-power standard. So countries like Germany and America try to build as many dreadnoughts as Great Britain. We can't, because the British are really good at building dreadnoughts. HMS Dreadnought was built in 14 months, whereas the first American dreadnought took 4 years to build. So we can't quite keep up, but we're really pushing the envelope and making them feel uncomfortable. During the Great War, construction in Europe slows down. The Germans realize that they can't build a fleet that's two-thirds the size of the British. So they won't ever be able to challenge the British and destroy enough of it that they can really win. So they switch over from building capital ships to submarines. The British, the French, the Italians, the Austro-Hungarians, they don't have the resources to put into their navies because they're building land forces. Really unsettlingly to them, though, America and Japan keep on building capital ships. The Treaty of Versailles, one of the main sticking points there that prevents it from being ratified really quickly, is the German High Seas Fleet, the second largest fleet in the world. It's been interred at Scapa Flow, but nobody knows what to do with it. Do the British get it and just have a huge navy now? The French really want it as reparations, but then their navy suddenly becomes as large as Great Britain. Where's this thing going to go? How are they going to parcel it out? There's a lot of arguments at the Treaty of Versailles about that, but luckily, the Germans sink their own ships rather than hand them over, and it saves everybody a lot of trouble in the long run. But immediately after the war's over, you have another arms race going on. America and Japan made it out of the war stronger than ever. They actually didn't have such a bad experience where their economies were wrecked like most of Europe. In fact, their economies came out pretty strong. So with the dreadnoughts, each succeeding class is a little bit bigger, a little bit better than the last one, but not so much. It's only a little bit of an improvement each time. The arms race after the war, you see ships planned to be built that are dramatically larger than anything that came before them. And eventually, next slide please. In 1922, everybody finally comes to their senses and says that we can't maintain this building pace. So you have the Washington Navy Treaty, which is the first arms limitation treaty ever. And it limits the size of people's fleets. It limits the size of ships they can build, and puts a building holiday on capital ship construction. So essentially, we're happy with what we have. We're happy with the balance of power that we have. We're happy with the size of ships. We're not going to build these super weapons that are planned for the late 1920s. As we know in hindsight, the Washington Navy Treaty did end the naval arms race, but it didn't necessarily achieve peace in our time. It didn't prevent World War II from happening, but it did stop a naval war from happening in the 1920s, so gave everybody a little bit of a breather. Next slide, please. Qualms, queries, questions, concerns, comments? Yes?
What kind of speed are you talking about on the various ships?
Pre-dreadnoughts tended to do 18 knots. Dreadnought herself could do 21 knots, which is about the speed of an average armored cruiser. And some countries, like America, were happy with that 21-knot speed. The fleet that was sunk at Pearl Harbor was a 21-knot fleet. So we didn't worry too much about upping the speed. The Japanese Navy moved to a 26-knot fleet. And the British Navy, they had a mixed bag. They had some ships that did 21 or 23 knots, and then they had some battleships that did 25 knots, the Queen Elizabeth class. And then, of course, they had their battle cruisers like Renown, Repulse, and Hood that were doing 28 to 30 knots.
Prior to radar coming into effect, in World War II, what's about the maximum effective range of fire given the maturity of fire control systems?
That's a very good question. About the best you can do is shoot to the horizon, which is 14 miles. You really can't score any hits at that range. I forget what distance it was at Jutland, but it was single digits, like 9 miles that they were scoring hits. The longest recorded shot ever came during World War II, and it was only 13 miles with radar fire control. It's the longest hit scored by a battleship.
So did they actually see at 9 miles around hitting or missing a ship?
Depending on the type of fire control they had, yes.
Or they're mainly looking for major damage, like smoke coming up.
They were looking for, all right, are we creating puffs of smoke or splashes? And then where are those splashes in relation to the ship we're shooting at?
I mean, splashes, even at that range, for most of those, most of the size that would be fired, this one's still hard to see. The Japanese had some pretty highly developed optics, I think, at the start of the war.
Mm-hmm.
But were theirs much ahead of the rest of the world?
It depended on each nation's philosophy. Great Britain's philosophy was to put a lot of shots out there. So they tended to put more emphasis on rate of fire than actual fire control. The Germans had very good optics and very good rate of fire because they were using smaller guns. So they tended to be able to zero in the range really early in a battle. Whereas the British, it took them a couple of salvos to start putting shots on target. And it's hard to say about America and Japan because, of course, they're saying that they've got really good fire control systems. But they never really used them during World War I. You don't see what they actually could do in combat. Like Jutland was foggy. It wasn't the best conditions. You had a choppy sea. So it's hard to say what they could have actually done in real battlefield conditions. Yes?
When you're talking about them improving the ships,
mm-hmm.
you realize you're also talking about the cost going up.
Yes.
And you're getting to the point where Britain... there was a combination out there that Britain would have been looking at. The idea of being twice as powerful as any combination, any two navies against them. And that was the idea of an alliance between Germany and the United States. Because that would have basically trumped the ability.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing is, look at it. The Brits were looking to build some battle cruisers, and they couldn't afford it, so two of the colonies came forward and agreed to Australia and New Zealand. We talk about what happened with HMS New Zealand at the Battle of Jutland, but she was scrapped as part of the Washington Naval Treaty. What most people don't realize is they didn't get through paying for HMS New Zealand until 1958.
Yes.
1921, though, Billy Mitchell had his bombing test where he demonstrated he could sink battleships with airplanes. Did that change battleship design or armor?
It really impacted how battleships, post-treaty battleships in the late 1930s and 1940s were built. But these World War I era ships were not, they didn't have much deck armor. They weren't so much designed for defense against even long-range plunging shellfire, much less aircraft. Yeah, but that was the one German battleship that wasn't scuttled at Scapa Flow was given to the Americans because the British knew that a ship built with metric units, the Americans weren't going to use it for anything other than bomb tests. Yes?
Can you talk about the disadvantages of coal firing and the advantages of oil firing in this whole context?
Oh, well, coal firing is much more labor intensive because you have to shovel the coal into the ship.
Slow.
And it's not quite as fast as oil firing. The advantage, though, was that there was already an established fueling network of coaling stations around the world, whereas when America starts to build the Nevada and the other oil-fired ships, we couldn't send them anywhere because there was no way to fuel them. So even when the U.S. sends a fleet to Great Britain late in the war, our most modern ships are kept at home because they're all fuel-burning, so we send our old coal-fired ships. Yes?
You don't have any use of gas warfare used by the navies against each other? Do they have gas shells deployable on naval ships?
I'm not sure about that. I've never heard of it being used.
If you think about it, gas is kind of an area-wide, you know, the thing you do to combat gas is wash it down with water. Ships are out on the ocean, they got water galore. And if you can actually get close enough to hit them with a gas shell, you can hit them with a high-explosive shell that's going to hit them and knock it down. Plus, ships can pressurize the positive pressure to keep gas out. So it's not really worth the effort.
Plus the airflow. I mean, if you've got a sailor, it's never still.
Well, yeah, true. Yes?
Is there anything that can be done or should be done to preserve the Olympia? It hasn't been in dry dock for about 90 years, and it's on its way to sinking to the bottom of the Delaware River.
Yeah, actually, I was just at the Historic Naval Ships Association conference. What was that, 2 weeks ago, Paul? 3 weeks ago, which was held up in Philadelphia, co-sponsored by the Olympia at Independence Seaport Museum. And they're in talks with other people to take the ship over and put it in dry dock. And in the meantime, they're doing a pretty good job of restoring her as best as they can. Paul, did you have anything else to add on the Olympia since you were there too?
There's a group in South Carolina, there's a group out of Mare Island, California, working together to try to raise the funding to save the vessel. And I only visited her for the first time in June. Actually, you and I went up there on a recon mission, so to speak, and never visited the Olympia. That ship is such an incredible missing link of naval technology. I literally got goosebumps walking through it because it's such a missing link between what has been preserved just by happenstance in many cases in this country and the historic American engineering of that time period that went into building that ship. Nothing convinces you it should be saved more than walking through and looking at that marvelous, marvelous time capsule. So they're in the process by Naval Sea Systems Command regulation of soliciting for proposals from other organizations take on the task of saving the ship. They're going through the process. The process will run through next year. I don't know how close they are. It is a ship that's in dire need of underwater hull maintenance. It's really tragic.
One other advantage of the oil firing occurs to me is that the coal smoke would reveal the ship's position much more than a cleaner burning fuel would. And they could see the smoke long before the ships came over the horizon.
Right, you are.
Fire.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
What was the war that was averted in the 20s in the last slide?
Oh, the naval arms race between Japan and America, the buildup there could very well have turned into an earlier version of the Pacific War that happened in World War II. Because those two countries were going all out. Yes?
You had a comment at all on the Japanese, if I pronounce it correctly, Yamato, super battleship that essentially was finally committed to a suicide mission.
18.1 inch guns. Yeah, the Yamato was the largest battleship ever built, and she came out in World War II. And she is very much, if you take the battleship design process all the way to fruition, that is the maximum. And she was designed very similarly to HMS Dreadnought to be able to take on multiple enemies, to be stronger than the next two strongest battleships that might face her. And luckily we didn't face her with battleships, we hit her with aircraft. Well, yes?
Yes, can you speak to the ship ratios that are named in the treaties in the earlier slide?
Oh, yeah, the United States and Great Britain had essentially five capital ships to every three that Japan was allowed to have. And then Italy and France also signed, and they had a 1 3/4 ratio there. So essentially that meant Japan had the most power in the Pacific because America had 2.5 in the Pacific and 2.5 in the Atlantic, and Great Britain would have had a third of her ships in the Pacific, a third in the Atlantic, a third in the Mediterranean. So there were some concessions there as to who would get the most power in their individual regions. And it was the first time that Great Britain accepted that we'll actually have naval parity with another country, that rather than continue to spend all that money, that they were willing to take the same number of capital ships as the Japanese. Yes? Yeah.
Didn't the Italians use torpedo destroyers against the Austrians?
Yep, that's the Svent Istvan right there, which an Austrian dreadnought that was sunk by Italian torpedo boats during World War I, late in the war, I believe. But yes, proof that you can use those cheap systems to easily destroy a really powerful unit. Now, I came here today for two things, to talk about battleships and for the free lunch. So I'm ready for the free lunch.
The yanks are coming, the drum coming everywhere. So prepare, say a prayer, send the word, to beware. We'll be older, we're coming older, and we won't come back till it's over there. Johnny, get your gun. Johnny, show the hug, you're a son of a gun. Hoist the flag.